Hello students, so are you ready to learn chemistry for this lecture series? So the first question that comes is, why do you need to study chemistry as a JEE or NEET aspirants? Why not history or some other subjects? Why are you made to study chemistry, physics and mathematics, or maybe physics, chemistry and biology for as a NEET aspirant? So the answer comes as something like this, that the chemistry is a part of the basic science, like with the physical sciences, life sciences, it comes. So in chemistry, the basic sciences, you try to understand the laws of nature. So which laws nature follows, once you understand those laws, you can apply those laws for the benefit of the people. And those portions of the science or the branches of science comes under the applied science, and engineering and medicine are the two examples of the applied sciences. So as a JEE aspirant, you definitely want to become an engineer, or as a NEET aspirant, you want to become a doctor, where you need to learn medicine and medicinal science. So one thing is that chemistry, if you go, it connects physical sciences with life sciences and applied sciences both. So as I said, applied sciences are engineering and medicine, and physical sciences, physics, mathematics, and geology, geophysics, this comes from the physical sciences. That's what is why chemistry is also called central science. A few years ago, I think in 2015, a science journal in USA, it's called Account of Chemical Research, it's publishing house, it has started a new journal with the name ACS Central Science, which is dedicated to only high quality research in chemistry. If you go even in more basics, we can see that our entire existence, our whole body is made up, is a consequence of chemistry or chemical processes. Like if we look at the digestion processes, so digestion, entire even hydrolysis of the food, everything is based on the chemistry, and immune response of our body, where the drug receptor, even recognition, targeting, everything is a chemistry. Functioning of drugs, functioning of our brain cells, even transmission of signals from one part of body to the other part. There are many neurotransmitters which are chemicals, they are involved. When our life starts with the fertilization of eggs, so even fertilization of egg is the basically it starts with the chemical process. And development of embryo, even movement of our muscles starts with is associated with many chemical changes. They are so complex that we don't observe them in our normal life. So even in the chemistry is very important in economical development of any country. Like as an engineer, you may want to contribute to the economics of the country or in any region where you will be living. If you come to the computers and mobiles, you know their chips, mobile chips and computer chips are made of silicon based materials. They are basically chemicals, and that is why the experiments done on computers are called in silico experiments. And this gives you the clue why the southern part of San Francisco is called Silicon Valley. Not only this, anything you starts from your toilet papers to even something about your shaving cream, everything that is that you use in your daily life comes from the chemical industry. Like, you know, cosmetics, food preservatives, oils, perfumes, dyes, soaps, sanitizers, drugs, metal alloys, cement, salt, anything that you, most of the things that you come back, also you can keep counting, they all come from the chemical industries. Fertilizers, just pesticides that we use for better production of crops, they also come from chemical industries. Electrical and electronic devices such as transistors, capacitors, even batteries like the lithium-ion battery that you use in, you know, in your mobile phones and your laptops, they also comes from chemistry and chemical industry or chemical research that people are doing right now. Other thing, like, you know, the plastics, you know how easy it made our life. So in the fossil fuel, the combustion of fossil fuels, not only even their purification, they are all chemical processes. And extraction of metals from their ores, these are also chemical processes. That is very good. And chemistry has not given us only good things. It has also some side effects. Not, it may not be side effects, you can say, but it has some drawbacks as well. And not drawbacks, it has given, its processes have been, gave us some pollution. Not pollution, any type of pollution, air, water, and soil pollution. Like even acidic grains that we encounter and we read in our newspapers, they are also related to the chemistry, because of the chemical processes, some amount of some chemicals they came, they were, which were not part of the air or soil, so they cause the pollution. So even global warming that we know is a consequence of chemistry. CO2 and methane, mostly these gases, they are causing and chlorofluorocarbons, they cause global warming. They also are chemicals, and they come from this chemical industry. And so what we say, that in short, chemistry, we can say that touches every facet of our life. So that's good. But what is chemistry? That we know chemistry is very important for us, our life, and even by and we also saw that why we need to learn chemistry before going into engineering and medicine. So the question is, what is chemistry? If I have to define chemistry, I can say it is, in one line, that chemistry is a bond forming and bond breaking process. So bond forming and bond breaking, that's these bonds may be a chemical bond or even a weak interactions. So these things about chemical bonds and weak interaction, we will learn in details in chemical bonding chapter. So in other words, we can also say that chemistry is understanding of interaction of material substances. Please note, material substances I am referring to, their interaction with other material substances or with the energy. It comes, everything that study, the systematic study, comes under the chemistry. So few laws of chemistry, you know, the physics is a very basic science, most basic science we call is physics. So few laws of physics that help us to understand chemistry, they are studied mostly in physical chemistry branch of the chemistry that we say right now. So there are some branch of chemistry where we extensively study about the compounds of carbons, which were initially isolated from living organisms. That's why it is called, the entire branch is called organic chemistry. Also, that you will also study in subsequent chapters. Chemistry of metals and non-metals. As I said, carbon is also a non-metal, but other than carbons, all non-metals and metals, their study comes under the inorganic chemistry branch. There are many other branches of chemistry which you may not have to read at this stage. So we have just seen that the interaction of material substances, that with another material substance or with energy, is called chemistry. So the question that comes now is, what is the matter or material substance? So you might have studied it in your 9th or 10th standard, or even before that in the 7th or 8th standard. So anything which has mass and occupies space and which can be felt by any of our senses is called a matter. Like, for example, you can see anything that you can sense, see, taste, everything that you encounter in your daily life is a matter. So these matters that you encounter in your everyday life, they can be found in three different states, and these states are defined as solid, liquid, and gas. Solid, that you see any substance which has a definite volume and definite shape, that you consider it as a solid. And anything which has a definite volume but it doesn't have a definite shape, like water or liquid or petrol, they are liquids. They comes under the liquids. And the gases have, like air or any oxygen, nitrogen, that you know, argon, they are gases. They do not have any definite shape or any even definite volume. In any vessel you put them, they will acquire the volume and shape of that vessel. So these three states of matter, they are interconvertible by changing the conditions of temperature and pressure. These are very important things to know. You encounter some numerical problems in your physical chemistry course later on this lecture series. So if you heat a solid, you will get liquid. So this process is called melting. The cooling of liquid is called, and then kind of getting, you can get back the solid. This process, the conversion of liquid to solid, is freezing. Similarly, the transition from liquid to gas is vaporization. Transition from gas to liquid is condensation. These terms will help you to understand chemistry. So you must know what is vaporization, what is condensation, what is melting, what is freezing, and what is sublimation. Like solid, direct transition from solid to gas is sublimation. And gas to solid, even without going into the liquid phase, it's called deposition or desublimation, is also a term which is frequently used. So that we see, matter could be in the solid state of liquid state and gaseous state. We can further classify the matter which could be solid, liquid, gas, that we don't bother about. We could classify them into a mixture or pure substances. Mixtures could be homogeneous mixture or heterogeneous mixture. And similarly, the pure substances could be elements or compounds. Mixture, you know, you mix a salt, pinch of salt with 1 kilogram of sand, or maybe 10 gram of sand. This all they are all mixture of sand and salt, you can say. You dissolve salt, any amount of salt, in any volume of water, it is a solution. So what does that mean? Its composition of a mixture is not constant, it is variable. It depends on how much amount you are mixing of different substances you are mixing. Like the example that we say in daily life is air. Even a tea you take, it is a mixture. The soil that we go for, even the agriculture processes, and even the rocks you see, they are all mostly they are mixtures. The solution, every kind of solution that you will go into your chemistry laboratories, they are examples of mixtures. One very important thing about the mixture that we need to remember is that materials that are mixed to make a mixture, they are called components. So the components of a mixture can be separated using physical methods. Means you can hand pick them. Definitely, if they are solid and you can see them from your naked eyes, you can hand pick them and separate them. Filtration, you know, every day your mother makes tea for you. So that process is filtration. So you, the solid, whatever the remnant of the tea, you separate from the liquid. So that is a filtration. Distillation, for example, you can say if you have a salt solution, you heat the salt solution to the extent that all water is completely evaporated. So what is the remnant is the salt in your vessel, and that water vapor you can also collect in a separate vessel. So this process is called distillation. So you can separate the salt solution by distillation. The crystallization is also a similar thing. That in crystallization, in one way, the way you can understand is you have a solution, you allow the solution for a sufficient time so that the solid substance, whatever it is, like if you have a solution of sugar in water, so you allow it for a certain amount of time so that the sugar is sheltered down on the palate of the vessel. So that is called crystallization. So these are physical processes by which you can easily separate the mixtures. So mixtures, as I said earlier, could be homogeneous. Homogeneous means the components of the mixture are completely mixed. Completely mixed means from any part of the solution of the mixture you take some sample, some amount, and you will find the composition all exactly same, or exactly may not be exactly, but almost same. You find, so you will call it as a homogeneous solution. That like air, we see the sugar solution, the salt solution, they are homogeneous mixture. There are also heterogeneous mixture. Heterogeneous mixture means their components are not uniformly distributed throughout. So sometimes different components are also visible in heterogeneous solution. Like if you mix pebbles, some kind of maybe some grains and pebbles, you can see them from your eyes, and you can separate easily by hand picking. So these are heterogeneous mixture. Even the food you eat, mixture of salt and sugar, the example I have gave, the porridge, the pudding that we eat, they are all the example of heterogeneous mixtures. So pure substances, what we say is they are made up of, they are very pure, means they are made up of one type of atoms. One type of atoms means they, all the atoms have almost, they are made up of is having the same chemical nature. Same chemical nature means they could be like, as we saw, elements or compounds, like the copper wire we see, the iron rod we see. They are, if they are pure, they, we say they are pure substances. The water you drink, water also contains distilled water, I mean to say. It is not the water we drink, it also contains many minerals. So water, the drinking water or potable water, you can say is a mixture. But the distilled water, when we say the purest form of water, is a pure substance. Like gold ornaments, if it is not mixed with some other metals, the pure gold is also a pure substance. The oxygen that we take for our survival, we inhale, is also a pure substance. So the, unlike mixture, the constituent of pure substances cannot be separated by simple physical methods. What does it mean is like water. Water, you know, it is made up of hydrogen and oxygen. It cannot simply by distillation or crystallization or hand picking by any physical method, you cannot separate hydrogen and oxygen from the water. So that is why we need to do a lot of research for using, like people are looking for using water as a fuel. They want to separate hydrogen from the water and use that hydrogen in a fuel cell. It's okay. So water, we saw, is made up of hydrogen and oxygen, and this hydrogen and oxygen, they cannot be separated by a physical method. Similarly, you know, the sugar or maybe the glucose, you know, it is a carbon made up of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, but you cannot separate them by physical, any of the physical methods. So the pure substances, we could be elements or they could be compounds. The elements are the materials which are made of only one type of atoms. Only one type of atom means all the atoms have the same nuclear charge. Same nuclear charge means you must be knowing about the number of protons that are present in the nucleus of any atom or atom. So that means the same number of protons every atom are present in the, of any element. So these elements could present, they could be present in even atomic forms, or maybe they exist also in the molecular forms in nature. Like all the metals that we see, they are mostly found in the atomic forms in the nature. Copper, potassium, sodium, even the noble gases, mostly we see the helium, neon, argon, krypton, they all exist in the atomic form. There are also some elements which are found in the molecular forms. Even though they are found in molecular forms, means same type of atoms, they are made up of same type of atoms, the same two atoms, they combine together to form a molecule. Like in the hydrogen, two hydrogen atoms, the same atom, they have same nuclear charge, they combine to form H2 molecule, and hydrogen basically exists as a H2 molecule. Not only hydrogen, the nitrogen, oxygen, chlorine, bromine, iodine, they all are gases, and they exist in homonuclear diatomic form. That we say homonuclear diatomic form because the nucleus of both the atoms are same and they are diatomic. They have two atoms. So simply, there are many other elements that exist in tetraatomic form, like the phosphorus. The elemental phosphorus exists in tetraatomic form. The elemental sulfur exists in octaatomic form. It's a very cased structure. You will see, probably will see in the group 16 elements chemistry. The atoms of different elements are different in nature, that you have to find out. It's the same way I am saying, the same sentence, that elements are made up of same one, only one type of atoms. It means that different elements have different type of atoms. Then what are compounds? So compound, it is defined as that they are also made of molecules, but these molecules, means the molecules of compounds, they are made up of different type of atoms. When they are combined together in a definite ratio, what is the definite ratio? We will see in the laws of chemistry, law of definite proportion and so on. So it means that, like in water, as I gave examples, two hydrogen atoms, when it mixes, when it combines, it is not mixed, but when it combines, they combine two atoms of hydrogen with one atom of the oxygen, we say that one molecule of water is formed. So water is a compound. Similarly, the sugar, the glucose that we saw initially, they are compounds. So hydrogen sulfide, the carbon dioxide that I mentioned, even methane that I mentioned as a global warming gas, they are all compounds. So methane is made up of carbon and hydrogen. One carbon atom combines with four hydrogen atoms, it makes methane. So carbon monoxide, carbon, one carbon, one oxygen. Carbon dioxide, one carbon, two oxygen atoms. So these are few examples of compounds. So properties of compounds are different from those of its constituent elements. This is one thing which you have to remember. What does it mean is, hydrogen, you know, is a gas. Oxygen, you know, is a gas. When they combine a hydrogen and oxygen, they form water. Water is a liquid. So the properties of water, which is a exists in the liquid form, is different than the hydrogen and oxygen, which are gas, which are gases. Another example you can say is hydrogen is a combustible gas. We know, as I mentioned, hydrogen before, we are thinking to use hydrogen or maybe extract hydrogen from water and use it in the as a fuel. So hydrogen is a gas, it is a combustible gas, and oxygen helps in combustion, but what we get after the combustion is water, which is a fire extinguisher. So you see how the properties of compound is different from its elements. So different kinds of matter around us have several characteristic properties. When you combine those properties, you can uniquely define a matter or any material substance. These properties, you can group them into two, and they are physical properties, you can say, or the chemical properties. What are the physical properties? The physical properties you can observe from outside. You can understand them without changing the identity of the composition of the substance. What does it mean is, you take a small sample from anywhere, from any source, and you find out the physical properties without changing the composition, you will get the almost same property, like the taste, color, odor, melting point, boiling point, density, viscosity, tensile and strength. These are all physical properties. These are properties which to measure them or to find them, you don't need to change the chemical composition of any substance. They are physical properties. There are chemical properties which are means that the reactivity defines the reactivity of a chemical compound or any pure substance, or even sometimes even a mixture. So these are the like composition, as we said initially, two hydrogen, one oxygen makes water. The combustibility, as I mentioned, hydrogen is a combustible gas. So how much, if one mole of hydrogen will give you, specifically if it is burnt in a presence of oxygen, so it will give you a fixed amount of energy. The reactivity, this water may react with different substances, so that you may not see, like even what the food we eat, like the glucose, the proteins, they all go to the chemical changes in our body, in our alimentary canal, the acidity, basicity. These are the chemical properties, and based on all chemical and physical property, you measure them, you find them, and based on them you can define what kind of substance it is. So measuring of the physical properties, you need to have some units, like, you know, volume. if we can measure volume, we can measure area, we can measure mass and temperature, anything. So if the boiling point, melting points, we can measure. So while measuring these things, whatever we write a number and after one unit that you always like. If I want, ask you, what is the mass of maybe some particular substance? You will say X gram or X kilogram. So X is a number that you are referring to, and after that you are mentioning the unit. The unit in which the mass is measured. So similarly, you use a scale in your geometry box. You might have made in your schools might have made different kind of structure, maybe different kind of triangles, squares, many things you might have made measuring maybe a line. So you say you measure it in maybe inches or centimeters or maybe sometimes even in millimeters. So that you say this 4.2, like 4.2 centimeter. So 4.2 is a number and centimeter is a unit. So what happened in initially different parts of world, the people were using different units. But once with the globalization, if what am I doing as a researcher and what people in the USA is doing as a researcher, if we use different units, we may not understand each other's chemistry easily. What people thought is we must stick to one unit, and for that in 1960 they established a standard unit, and that is called International System of Units, or SI system. And the SI system has basically 7 base units. These 7 base units are for 7 fundamental scientific quantities. These fundamental scientific quantities are length, mass, time, electric current, thermodynamic temperature, amount of substance, and luminous intensity. Based on these 7 basic quantities, you can derive and their units, you can derive any unit for any physical quantity. That is from the relation, you know, like the volume, you know, what the volume is, length into width into the height. So length of unit of length is meter, SI unit. Unit of width is also meter, SI unit of height is, you can also say, which is also a meter. So meter into meter into meter is a meter cube. So the unit of volume is a derived unit. So you can get like even the speed. It's from its equation, it is a distance traveled by the time elapsed. So unit of distance, you know, it's a meter, SI unit, and the time is, SI unit is second. So meter divided by second, so meter per second is the unit of SI unit of speed, or maybe velocity you can also say. So these are derived units and they are tabulated here. So length, the SI unit of length is meter. You can read this, and the time is second, the mass you might have read in your 9th standard physics is kilogram, electric current it is ampere, temperature the unit of temperature is Kelvin, the amount of substances are reported or represented in mole, you represent it as mol, luminous intensity you represent it as cd, or the unit is candela. But in chemistry, these units, if I say 1 kilogram, it's a very huge mass. If you want, I want to make some chemical, maybe perform some chemical reaction. So if I take 1 kilogram of substance, it's too huge. It's a wastage of money. So usually we don't take such a huge amount. We take a smaller amounts of substances to test our theory or whatever the chemical reactions or chemical transformation you want to study. So in chemistry, what I mean to say is if we use a smaller units, a small of substances means a small amount of substances we take. So we generally stick to a smaller units, and like the masses we mostly measure in gram. So it is used in the numerical problems. Mostly you will see that the it is an X gram of a chemical substance reacts with maybe Y gram of another chemical substance and makes this, and the question you may see that they ask, what is the yield of the reaction? So the gram, we must need what is the relation of gram with the kilogram, that is the SI unit of the mass. This 1 kilogram is equal to 1000 grams. So you need to understand this. If someone asks you to represent your answer into the SI unit, So you must need the, must know this conversion. Like similarly, volume, the SI unit of volume is meter cube, but generally meter cube means it's too much. You might have might be knowing what is 1 liter of milk. So you see how much 1 liter of milk is, and 1 meter cube is 1,000 liter. So even if you want to mix to maybe liquids, some substances are dissolved in solution. So if you want to, you cannot go to 1,000 liter of two solutions and mix some heavy acid and base to perform a reaction or neutralization. So you need even for smaller units. So that we go for the liter or even the milliliter. Milliliter is also represented as centimeter cube or cc. Sometimes in the numerical problems we will also see. So liter the is represented as capital L, or we also say the decimeter cube. It's a decimeter cube. And milliliters ml or cm cube or cc, we say the relation between 1 meter cube and liter is written here. And the milliliter or maybe meter cube and milliliter is 1 meter cube is 10 to the power 6 milliliter, and 1 liter is 1,000 milliliter. That these are some things which you need to know for the which will help you in solving numerical problems. Similarly, if I say the density is SI unit of density, we can derive from the formula is density is mass divided by volume. So SI unit of mass is kilogram and volume is meter cube. So it's a kg per meter cube. So but does it means, but generally in chemistry that we represent a density of a substance in gram per milliliter or gram per cc. So from this things, this you can reconvert gram per milliliter to kg per meter cube, or even if the density is given in kg per meter cube, and to solve the problems you need to convert it into the gram per milliliter. So you can convert these things by using the above relation, like kilogram to gram and meter cube to milliliter that I have just told you about. Another thing is like temperature. That SI unit of temperature is Kelvin, but you also see that temperature is given in degree centigrade. So we get the Kelvin temperature in Kelvin from this equation, means the temperature in Kelvin can be obtained by adding the temperature in degree centigrade with 273.15. 0.15 you can ignore. You can simply add temperature in degree centigrade with the 273 and you will get the temperature in Kelvin. So what does it mean that in chemistry, not as we show that we don't deal with whatever the SI units in those units. They are very large units in some cases. We deal in the smaller, even sometimes even more bigger numbers. Like if I say Avogadro number, you can see here how many zeros are there in Avogadro number. And if you look at the Planck's constant, you can see how many zeros are after decimal point. If I say you to remember these numbers in this form, it will be very difficult for you to remember, and doing mathematical operations will be even further difficult. Similarly, mass of hydrogen atom, you know, you can see what is this number, how many zeros are after decimal points. So if I say you charge on an electron, you know, it's 10 to the power order of 10 to the power 19 minus 19. So the speed of light, it is a 3 lakh kilometers, kilometer not meter, per second. So it's also a very huge number. So for huge numbers to represent them in the numbers which we can understand or we can remember easily, and even we can perform mathematical operations very easily, we resort to a scientific notation. And scientific notation is something like is a exponential notation, we also say. So any number can be represented in the form of n capital N into 10 to the power n. So I am just sticking here to the notation that is given in your NCERT book, so that even if you read the NCERT book, you don't have to remember different notations given at the different points. So n is of any number which is called a digit term, which could be of the order 1.00 could be at that any number points of decimal to 9.999. And n, a small n is a exponent, it's an integer. Could be, for example, as I said, the Avogadro number that we saw initially, you see here, how many zeros are there. So we can represent this number in scientific notation as 6.022 into 10 to the power 23. Now you can remember it easily and you won't get confused with the zeros. And even similarly, the Planck's constant, you see here how long it is. So we can represent it in the scientific notation as 6.626 into 10 to the power minus 34, which its unit, meter square kg per second. So now these numbers becomes too easy for us to remember and to do even mathematical operations. Few rules, those are not very difficult rules, we need to remember for doing mathematical operations on these numbers represented in the scientific notation. So these numbers could be follow the law of indices. You might have read in your class 7th or 8th, whatever class, those rules even in the later classes. And for example, if I say here, so if I have to multiply 5.6 into 10 to the power 5 to 6.9 into 10 to the power 8, what I would do is these digit terms I can separate them, and these exponent terms I can also separate them. The exponent terms I can directly add because their base are same. So 10 to the power 5 plus 8, and you know these digit terms you can multiply directly, and so you will get this number. Similarly, in divisions, another example is given there. You can see in your slide and understand. So I'll go directly now to the division. So this is 2.7 into 10 to the power, 10 to the power minus 3 is divided by 5.5 into 10 to the power 4. So again, we separate the exponent term and the digit terms. So digit terms, you divide digit terms by digit term and the exponent terms by exponent terms. So in division, you know, we subtract the base power if we put them above. So this is these things are very easy, you know, I don't want to waste time here. So what, one thing is the addition and subtraction. Just one thing you have to remember is, while doing addition and subtraction, you have to do is to make the components same of the two numbers. First to do is make the components same, like if we have 6.65 into 10 to the power 4 and 8.95 into 10 to the power 3. So what we will do is we first make the exponents same. So 6.65 into 10 to the power 4, if I write it as the same. Now 8.95 into 10 to the power 3, I can write it as, if just placing decimal to the left toward by one point, I can make it 0.895 into 10 to the power 4. Now we have same exponents. We can take these exponents common and add the digit terms directly. So you add like this here, and you get the addition as 7.545 into 10 to the power 4. Similarly, you do in the subtraction. What you do is, like example given here is 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 2. If I have to subtract from this number, 4.8 into 10 to the power minus 3. Again, I'll make the exponents of the two numbers same. So 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 2, I can keep same. I can change the second number convert into 10 to the power minus 2 exponent, like here I can make it 0.48 into 10 to the power minus 2, and now take 10 to the power minus 2 common and subtract the digit terms, I will get the answer is 2.02 into 10 to the power minus 2. You can do it otherwise. You can change the exponent of the another number as well, like you can change the exponent of 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 2 to the 10 to the power minus 3. Like you can make it 25 into 10 to the power minus 3 and keep the second number same, and you will arrive at the same answer. This another thing that you need to remember is, like here in chemistry we also represent these numbers, or maybe the units, as a prefix. We put some prefix before some unit. Like I said, in chemistry we generally use masses in grams, because it's more, or maybe milligrams sometimes. or sometimes even micrograms in biological samples people use. So if I say the kilogram, we know what is the SI unit of mass is kilogram. So what does it mean if I just replace K, the kilogram of K as 10 to the power 3 as here? So suppose I have 5 kilogram, I say to convert it into the gram. So 5 kilogram, what you will write, 5 into at the place of kilo K, you will write 10 to the power 3 and gram. So it will be 5 into 10 to the power 3 gram. Similarly, you can do it even with the milligram. So am I the milliliter, as we say, the liter, we know, say 4 liter, 4 liter will be equal to, if I say convert into the milliliter, so 10 to the power minus 3, I'll multiply, and plus 3, I'll multiply and say it is milliliter. If I say 4 milliliter, if I have to convert it into the liter, so I say milli at the place of milli, I'll put 10 to the power minus 3. So I'll say 4 into 10 to the power minus 3. Milliliter is liter. So similarly, what you don't have to, this is given this table I took from your NCERT book. You may not need to remember this long table. What you may encounter is from pico, maybe the femtometer or femtoseconds that we do chemistry sometimes in femtoseconds. Even the dimensions of the atoms or even subatomic particles comes under this, they are in this order of picometer or femtometers. So from femtometer and to tera, you know, the our hard disk memory, we say that this, that's 1 terabyte, 5 terabyte or 1000 terabyte, something like this, you say the memory. So from femtometer to the tera, something femto to tera, you just remember rest of the things. If you remember, that is okay. If you don't remember, you don't have to bother. But rest of the things like mega, giga, mega, you must know, because sometimes energy is reported in mega kilocalorie or mega joule or something like this, like nuclear energy, nuclear transformations. So million electron volts, sometimes some mega electron volt people say. So these things you will encounter in your numerical problems. So I'll go further. Like then this, we know what is the about the physical measurements, and we also learned about the units, different kinds of units and SI units and their representation, and also we saw some units that are frequently used in chemistry, the smaller units of the physical quantities. Now if someone is doing experiments, chemistry is mostly an experimental science. So in experiment you do measurements. While doing measurements, there are two things which you have to take care of, or you have to be very careful about that. One is called precision and another is called accuracy. So for a measurement to be reliable, or for an experiment to be reliable, you have your experiment should be, or results, or the data you obtained from your results should be very precise and accurate. What precision means? Precision means the closeness of various measurements. Means you do, suppose, 5 experiments for the same reaction, of same kind of experiments, same time of type of experiments you do 5 times, and you obtain some data for something, and you will get definitely 5 results. So how closely those results are with each other, that you represent as a precision. If they are very close to each other, you will say that, oh, my results are very precise. And how close they are to the real or maybe the true value, that we also call the expected value or the correct value, that we say we represent it, it's represented as an accuracy. So the one example I gave here in this table is, following table is, like 3 students made 3 measurements for the boiling point of water. You know what is the boiling point of water? It's 100 degrees centigrade. And got the values. They did 3 different experiments. Each of them did 3 different experiments. And the student one got maybe the, suppose in experiment one, he got 101 degrees centigrade, the boiling point. Another experiment, he got 101.1. And the next third experiment, he got 100.9. You can see these numbers are very close to each other. So you can say that, oh, his results are very precise. The student So he did three experiments and he got the boiling point as 99.1 in experiment one. Another experiment he got 99.0, and the next experiment he got 100.9 or something like this. So you can see these three numbers are not very close to each other. 99.9 and 99.0 they are very close, but 100.9 is not very close. So you can say these results are neither precise or not accurate. In first experiment, the student was not accurate because boiling point he should ideally get is close to 100 degrees centigrade, but he got around the average, if we say is around 1.1. Neither the second student, his results are neither precise. You can see they are scattered, nor accurate because the different values are too either very low or very high from the real boiling point of water. The experiment student three in three different experiment he got the values like 100 degrees centigrade, 100.1 degrees centigrade, and 90.9 degrees centigrade. So we'll say that these results, when the experiment results obtained by student three, they are precise as well as accurate. That's why these results only results obtained by student three are the reliable results in chemistry. Say so for a data to be reliable in chemistry or experimental science, your results or the should be, or measurements should be very precise and accurate. So while reporting this experimental results or the data, we also need to stick to few basic rules, and these basic rules actually tells you about the like you in physics, maybe later on you will read about learn the least count of any measuring instrument. Like I mentioned earlier, like the geometry box contains some scale. Using that scale, you cannot measure 0.2 or 0.1 millimeter because it's a centimeter. You can say 4.1, 4.2 centimeter you can measure, but it has no lines for millimeters or something, so you cannot measure that. So everything, like even the centimeters are more accurate than millimeters, the small bars that you see there, because where you put the while putting point you may make some errors. So the decimal, the millimeter, the measurement from those scales are not very reliable. So that those are called least count, and you will further better understand it in your physics laboratories or physics lectures. So experimental measurements are associated with some amount of uncertainty, that we say as uncertainty. Like using those scales, there is uncertainty in measuring some millimeters. So these uncertainties are due to two reasons. There could be the because of the limitation of measuring instruments, as I said, like the scale, and even the skill of the person that is doing the measurement. It also depends on that. If the person is very skilled, he'll make the measurement very accurate or close to accurate, or the using the same scale. So these are the two things. So what we learned is uncertainties are based on the limitation of measuring instruments and the skill of the person that is making the measurement. So what is for example, mass measured using the platform balance is reliable only up to the first place of decimal. That the platform balance, we measure our own mass of maybe the weight we encounter. But analytical balance you use in your chemistry laboratories, it gives the mass which is reliable up to the fourth place of decimal. So you see, if you use the platform balance and you report that I have measured the mass of a substance which is 5.543 kilogram, so you are wrong. It's only reliable up to the first place of the decimal. You cannot say it's more than 4.2. Beyond that, it is having uncertainty. So you can say it is 4.1, or maybe you cannot say using that balance, or maybe that. So similarly, the reporting the mass beyond the first place of decimal using the same thing I am just reading again, using platform balance is unreliable. So significant figures talk about to how many digits the data is reliable. So data means the data you measured doing experiments. So meaningful digits which are known with certainty plus one which is estimated plus one which is estimated are uncertain. Means what I mean to say is like if you are measuring 4.2 centimeter on a using a scale that you use in your geometry box, so there is uncertainty up to the at the first place of decimal, as I mentioned earlier. So you cannot say with the certainty, no, if I measure 4.2 centimeter, it is exactly 4.2 centimeter. No, you cannot say. While putting the points, you may make some error. So that there is some uncertainty at the second place. So what you can say is 4. So 4 is the certain value. This is the meaningful value. And the second digit or the last digit that you say is uncertain. So up to 2 points that you can only report. So you say here that the 2, 4 and 2, there are 2 significant figures. You can report only using those numbers. You may have 10.2, you can have a centimeter, so it will have 3 significant figures. So there are certain rules that we stick to while counting the significant numbers or significant figures. So there are 4-5 rules that we need to learn and remember. The first rule is all non-zero digits are significant. For example, if I say and I'm like 4.962 centimeter, so there are 4 digits and they are all non-zero digits. So the significant figures I say related to this measurement is 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4 digits are there, the significant figures are 4. So you can report up to the 4 digits only. And in this, the first 3 digits are certain and the last digit, maybe that is 2, is uncertain. It could be 4, but in reality 4.96, 2 point something or 963 or 961. While making measurements using some scale, you might do some error. So that is related to that, the uncertainty. Like another example, 4.25 milliliter, if I say there are 3 significant figures. So 4, 2, they are all 3 non-zero digits. The second rule is the zeros preceding to first non-zero digit are not significant. For example, and this zero merely indicates the position of decimal point. For example, in the number 0.251, the significant figures are only 3. The number of significant figures are only 3. The zero, this zero is not considered as a significant, the first zero, because it's coming before the non-zero digit. Like here, the 0.09, we have only 1 significant figure. In the number 0.0052, other than 52, all the numbers are zero and they are left to the non-zero digits. So the significant figure here are 2. The next number is also say the significant figures is also 2. The zero between 2 non-zero digits are significant. For example, like 101. So zero is between 2 non-zero digits, like 1 and 1. Between them, we have put the zero. So the significant numbers we will count here is 3. In the number 2.045, the zero is also there between 2 non-zero digits. So the significant here in the next example is 4. The zero at the right of non-zero digits are, there are 2 things in this case. If non-zero digits you are saying, and if they are at the right of non-zero digits, when the zero is right of the non-zero digits, if they are considered to be significant, if this zero comes after the decimal. Decimal, please don't confuse with the way in the rule second that we have seen, like 0.025. The first zero is before any non-zero digit. But in this example, like 4.010, this zero is after the, it is right to the first non-zero digit. So this zero is considered as a in the significant figure. So the number of significant figures in this number will say is 4. So because these zeros, they comes after the decimal point and decimal before the decimal point, some non-zero digit is there. In the next number, we also see the significant figures is 4. The number we said 200.0. So all those significant figures 4. In the next example, 200.00. The number of significant figures we said is 5. Another rule for zeros that comes after the comes to the right of non-zero digit is they consider non-significant. Zero are non-significant if there is no decimal point before the zero, like 200. In 200, we say the only the significant number of significant figures is 2. If I say 1,000, the number of significant figures is only 1. 1,200, the number of significant figures will be 1 and 2 and means 2 only 2. Another example, 460, we have, will have only 4 and 6, they are only significant. So significant figures will be 2. So these numbers, when we represent them in scientific notation, we find the significance figures more easily. Like 200, we can represent them as 2 into 10 to the power 2. So that we see here, 2 is only the significant figure. Like another thing, 200.0. 200.0, we can write it is the 2.00 into 10 to the power 2. So the number of significant figures we can understand is 4 here. And another example I have given, which you can see. So number of objects, another rule is number of objects. If you count some object, so in such in the countings, the significant figures could be infinite. Like so, if you are counting like 5 dots, so you can write 5 ducks exactly as 5 or 5.0, 5.00 to the any 5.00 up to the infinite place of decimal. That exact. Now we are counting the your counting is exact. That's why you can have infinite significant figures in the in counting the objects. So these are few rules that we needed to understand. Another thing is all the digit of number represented in scientific notation that you also remember, but I have discussed it earlier. So all the digits of numbers represented in scientific notation are significant. For example, here 3.012 into 10 to the power 1 has 4 significant figures. 9.2 into 10 to the power 9 has 2 significant figures. The next number has 5 significant figures. As we see, 7, 4, 5, 9, 2, they are all significant. So we'll have 5 significant figures. The next thing is like while doing mathematical operations, you have to follow certain rules of the significant figures as well. So the what does it mean is that what we say the results while doing mathematical operation of addition and subtraction, you cannot have more digits to the right of the decimal point than any of the original number. For example, we have 3 numbers that we want to add, like 4.962 and 3.9 and 2.62. We want to add them. So we can simply add them and the addition we got the value is 11.482. But we cannot, in chemistry, we cannot report answer as 11.482. This is because the 3.9 has only 2 significant has only one the report has one after only one place of decimal in one of the measurements we got the value. It means this measurement if we are adding it, the rest all the numbers will be uncertain after the maybe after the first place of decimal. So the answer we can write only up to the first place of decimal. It means we have to round off this number 11.482 to the first place of the decimal only. So rounding it, you will get 11.5. So you need to report the answer as 11.5 and not as 11.482. In another example, suppose you are adding 3 to 4.011 and 9.0911. Adding these 4 numbers, 3 numbers, you may get that value as 16.1021. But as I said earlier, you cannot report it as this in chemistry. This is because of the uncertainty after the even the first place of decimal. In one of the measurements, we didn't get any measurement in the decimal point in first measurement. So we will not report any data in the decimal point in this case. So the all we have to round up this answer up to the 60. Without we cannot put anything after decimal, because up to that we our measurements are not reliable, so we cannot put them. The third, like in subtraction, you know there are three digits. When digits in subtracting them, suppose I get 11.664 in this this example. Similarly, I cannot report but this number in chemistry, or maybe the after doing the experiment, because this number 0.41 has only two digits after the decimal. So our answer only should contains the number only up to the second place of decimal. So the answer will be 11.66. Similarly, we can have like the in the fourth example, we got the subtracting these numbers, or maybe operation subtracting and adding different numbers, we got the answer 0.431. But here in the fourth digit, if you can see here, I am pointing it here. So we don't have any number. We are not reporting it after any point of decimal. So our answer will be zero. It's not 4.431. We cannot write it. Similarly, we also have to follow some rules in multiplication and division. And these rules, again, you do the multiplication. What I mean to say is you do the operation, and after that you truncate your number to only certain decimals or certain points which are only reliable. Unreliable values you cannot represent, like, and there you need to know the rules of rounding of the numbers. Similarly, in the multiplication and division, what we stuck to is we see the number with the smallest significant number. What we remember here is in addition and subtraction, we see the number which has the reported means which has the least digits after the decimal points. Least number of digits after the decimal points in subtraction and addition we wanted to see first before doing the operation. But in multiplication and division, we see the number with the least number of significant figures. So like in the first example here, we have two numbers, 3.31, and we want it 3.31 to multiply with 1.2. And after multiplication, we get the number, the answer is 3.972. But if we look at this number 1.2 carefully, we will have only that this number 1.2 has only two significant figures. So we need to report our answer in only two significant digits only, up to two significant numbers only. So the answer will be 4.0. We'll have to round up this. Another example again, 0.03 into 98.1. In the 0.03, we see only the number of significant figures is one only. So the zero, these two zeros are before the first non-zero digit. So the significant figure in 0.03 is only one. So after multiplication, if we get 2.943, but we cannot write it, our answer will be 3. In division, again, we say the same rule. These two numbers, once after division, we get this answer, maybe after the up to the first place of decimal, but we will have to round up of it only up to the three places of decimal, only up to the four significant figures. Because this number, the first number, has only four significant figures. So our answer will only be 1.977, which all numbers are significant in this case. In the next example, 11.301. So the first number has two significant numbers, a significant figures. The second number has three significant figures. The division will get 3.654, but we cannot report up to this 3.654 has four significant figures. But from our rules of division, we know we can report only up to the two places of, only up to the two significant figures only. So the answer will be 3.7. We will again round off this number. So you saw what we need is, while doing mathematical operations and sticking to the laws of significant figures, we need to know certain rules as well. Those rules are called as rounding off rules. So there are few things, the three rules that you need to remember for rounding off any number. The first rule is, if the rightmost digit to be removed is more than 5, the preceding number is increased by 1. The example, if I see 1.3854. So I want to remove this two digits, 5, 4. So the last, this is 5 digit, and before 5, the preceding number is 8. So if I want to remove 5, 4, and this 5, 4 is more than 5, of definitely it is more than 5, this number. So if I remove this, I'll have to 1 in the preceding number. So the my answer will be 1.39. So if I remove 5, 4, I'll have to add 1 to 8. So the answer will be 1.39. This way, if the third example, if the another example is 5.698. If I want to remove this 8 and round off this number only up to the second place of decimal, so I'll have to write it as a 5.70, because 5 is more than 5, and once I remove it, I'll have to add 1 to the number that precedes 8. So if I add 1 to 9, it will become 10. So the carry forward I'll have to add to the 7, so it will become 5.70. Similarly, the another number that you can say, if I want to remove this 8 1, I will have to add, is again, this is more than 5, so I'll have to add 2. That's one to the this number that precedes it. So it will become minus 9.693. So this is the way that you do one examples, means one rule. Means if you want to remove some digits which are more than 5, then you will have to follow this rule. There are another rule, if the number that you want to remove or the digit you want to remove is less than 5, for example, then you will, what you do is you leave the preceding number unchanged. You don't have to do anything. You just remove the digit you want to remove when it is less than 5, like 4.6911. So you can remove 1 directly, because it is less than 5. You don't have to do anything, add anything. So your answer will be 4.69. In the next example, 3.9202. Suppose if you want to report your answer only up to the first place of decimal, because of the rules that you follow for the significant figures. So what you do is, you remove this number when this number is, this digit 2 is less than 5. So you just remove it and leave the number unchanged, rest of the part unchanged. So you get this. In the next example, like 0.595. Suppose if I want to report the number in the integer form, like maybe I'm close to the integer, if I have to remove all that set decimal points, like earlier we saw the example here, like the division, the second example, only up to the first place of decimal only we will have to report, when the answer we will have to report in one significant figure. Suppose if I have to remove this observation, maybe this result of my mathematical operation in up to the only one significant figure, so I'll round up this number, and this number 5, this is up to here, it's more than 5, something like this, it's more than 500, so I'll round up this as 1, because it is more than 5. If the, suppose the rightmost digit that you want to remove is exactly 5, then the preceding number, then you have two different rules. They are just slight divergence you have to follow. If suppose the, so if exactly 5, like in example 5.405, so I want to remove 5, which is exactly 5, as I said. So if I want to remove, what I show is 5.0. So it's a kind of even number. So if the number, the preceding number is an even number, we don't have to do any change. We just remove the 5. Another example, 3.65. The 5 we want to remove, it is exactly 5, and the number, or maybe 500, you can say. And if this is 6 is the preceding number, to 5 is 6, which is an even number. So I just have to remove 5 and leave the things as such. So the answer will be 3.6. Similarly, in the third example, 10.250 here, if I want to remove 50, what I have to do is, the 2 is an even number, so I'll remove 50 and the answer that I'll report as 10.2. Another example that this notation is wrong, so it's the second variant of this is if the number is exactly 5 but the number that precedes 5 is an odd number, if it is an odd number like 7.75. so like maybe if suppose you got your CGPA score as 7.75, example I am giving, and someone asks you to report it only up to the first place of decimal, so what will you do? You have to round up it to the first place of decimal. So round this 7 is since odd number, you will have to write 7.8. similarly 4.15, that here 5 is before 5, the digit that precedes it is 1, so I'll have to add 1 to this number, digit 1, so the answer will be 4.42. The example -6.350, 50 I want to remove, I want to report the answer only up to first place of decimal, that the 3 is an odd number, so I'll have to add 1 to this 3, so the answer will be -6.4. so this is how we do the mathematical operations using the laws of significant figures, and we report our results in that. So this is the only I planned for today's lecture. In the next lecture we will see the different laws that we see in chemistry, and we will read one by one with the examples, and we'll see that.
Welcome to Sushruta app. In this video we are going to demo NEET topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select biology 11th as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the first subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the third icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from IITPAL. If there are more than one video, select any one of the links and watch the video. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, taxonomic categories, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook. So here we have the textbook resource showing taxonomic categories. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for Biology Unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the biology syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon, that is Gyan Chat. Gyan Chat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Gyan Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let us click the textbook icon, and select the second option. This will open up a message box, displaying the page number, of the Kindle version of HC Verma book. On clicking OK it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top, and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box, asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Now let us see the formula sheet for physics. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside my bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app, where you can try out mock tests. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF. In some cases, there will be video content, graphic and interactive content. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Hello, my dear students. Very glad to meet you all. I am Prof. G.K. Bhatt. In 2018 or during 2018 to 2020, I got an opportunity to visit nearly 25 institutions. And I used to teach in all these institutions biology, preparing the students for NEET exam. For NEET exam, you must be thorough with each and every word given in the NCERT book. That means biology, you have to by heart the NCERT book. Not simply by heart, understanding the concept and by heart. That is what is expected. Now let us start with this particular chapter, that is Animal Kingdom. And we shall look into the various components that is given here in the NCERT, in the Animal Kingdom. Under basis of classification, what we are looking, what characters, what points we are looking to classify the animals, that is what we are studying under basis of classification. In spite of differences in structure and form of different animals, there are a lot of difference in the structure, in their form, gross morphology. There are certain fundamental features common to various individuals. In relation to arrangement of cells, body symmetry, nature of coelom, patterns of digestive system, circulatory system, or
respiratory. We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.